Governor Godwin Obaseki of Edo State may have finally defected to the People's Democratic Party for the All Progressive Congress, but winning his new party's governorship ticket unopposed may not be plain sailing after all. A report by our sister outfit this day says despite the sustained pressure on the contenders for the party's governorship ticket for September elections, they have refused to budge. According to the report, he has three PDP governorship aspirants, Gideon Ikene, Agbede Ihiama, and Kenneth Imaswagbo, who have so far rebuffed pressures from the leaders of the party for them to step down for Obaseki, who formally defected to the party last Friday alongside his deputy, Honorable Philip Shoaibu. Before Obaseki's defection, the PDP had screened and cleared the trio for the primary, which was supposed to have been conducted by this last weekend. In the meantime, the dynamics of the people's of the politics ahead of the APC primary election, which is expected to hold today, seem to have dramatically changed over the weekend with the reports that suspension placed on their battle party chairman, Adams Oshiomhole, had been lifted. That report, however, being contested by a member of Oshiomhole's ward executive committee. I mean, let's go straight to this morning. This is quite very surprising. This brouhaha and broglie, what you want to call it, has turned around over the weekend. And I'll tell you this strongly. I think the Oshiomhole camp took a toll from what Bwala said here, Daniel Bwala, last week, that if he can get his party at the ward to lift the suspension, then he stands a better chance to be able to claim back his governorship seat. When we had Daniel Bwala here of the APC, he said that. Also, we are seeing a resurgence from the other candidates, the likes of Kenneth Imaswagbo and other stakeholders in the PDP, saying, we will not step down for Governor Godwin Obaseki. I mean, what is really happening?
No, what is happening is that Governor Obaseki may have jumped from a frying pan into fire. He may have been able to stand up for himself. Some people have compared him to Governor Ambode of Lagos when he was confronted with a similar situation. But in his own case, he has taken the step of moving out of his party, the APC, and going to the other party, the People's Democratic Party. But what we're now seeing is that even in the People's Democratic Party, the welcome for him and those who followed him, including his deputy, is not total. Because if you look at the protest by Imaswagbo very closely, he says, look, he too has been nursing the ambition to be governor for 16 years. And that if anybody should step down, it should be, you know, the new commander should step down for him. So the impression that is being given by, you know, Imaswagbo and others, the two others who had been aspirants on the platform of the PDP, is that, look, the PDP is trying to do the same thing that the APC in Edo State had been accused of. Mm. That is the imposition of a candidate and the imposition of a newcomer, because Obaseki will need to get a waiver. Now, if he gets that waiver...
He has gotten a waiver.
Yes, if he gets that waiver affirmed, if it's affirmed, and he is imposed further in the primaries that had to be shifted to accommodate him, then, of course, there are persons within the party in Edo State who are now saying, we will not accept it. Now, how that plays out will be a question of diplomacy within the party. Would the leaders of the party, Senator Bala Mohammed has been appointed the leader of the team to oversee the primary, would they be able to manage the situation? Otherwise, they could find aggrieved persons within the PDP also moving out of the party and going to another party. And that could have implications also for the chances of the PDP.
What I was going to say is that I found it a bit eyebrow-raising for Governor Obaseki, a newcomer in the PDP, to address the press and declare himself the leader of the party in the state.
Wow.
Just because you're governor, I don't think that was really the right tone to strike, especially since somebody like Imaswagbo has been the voice of dissent from the start. Yeah. And now the other two aspirants have joined into that chorus and are resentful of the fact that they're just being sidestepped in this manner. I don't think he should have declared himself the leader of the party. So I think that might cause some problems.
I just want to ask further, then what is the way forward for these two parties? Because one thing I see, there's going to be an underpinning of a lot of legal wranglings. I know for a fact, if Obaseki gets the ticket out of the PDP, the likes of the Imaswagbo will look for a reason to go to court.
Well, is there the possibility of a third option for the people of Edo State? Because what you had in 2016 was Eze Yamu versus Obaseki. Now, in 2020, we've been presented with the possibility of the same, you know, balance of powers, except that the platforms have been reversed. Now, I think we should continue to insist on the people of Edo State having a say in the matter. The Oba of Benin has said godfatherism is not an option. But what are the people themselves saying? The voice of the people has not been heard yet. And I hope that when that election is held, eventually, the people of Edo State will show their own independence and, you know, vote with their, you know, with their cards and make a choice in the matter, because that is what should matter in a proper democracy. And as to the gladiators, they should, as I've always repeated, eschew violence and ensure that their priority is peace and progress and the development of Edo State, which seems not to be a subject on the table at this time.
You know, they always say the voice of the people is the voice of God. Vos populi, vos dignus. But in Nigeria's democracy, it has never been the case. Let's see if we can take this quick story. Nigeria's Governor Forum said the Nigerian Association of Resident Doctors has agreed to shelve its strike. The doctors embarked on a nationwide strike last week, despite the ongoing fight against COVID-19 pandemic. Some of their demands include implementation of the Medical Residency Training Act in all federal hospitals and pay parity among doctors of equal cadre. After a meeting with the governor of Ekiti State and chairman, Nigerian Governors Forum, Kayode Fayemi, the doctors agreed to suspend their strike, and the doctors have given the government 4 weeks to do all that is necessary to meet their demands. The doctors, I heard them. Real quickly, before we go to break, the doctors said they are putting, they are casting their hopes on the Nigerian Governors Forum. That was their words exactly. That was NERD's word, National Association of Resident Doctors. Well, what do you say about this, Tundun?
Well, I'm really relieved that at least there's a suspension. It hasn't been called off, it's been suspended. Yeah. That's good news for the patients who have missed the doctors. It's been suspended for 30 days, and I hope that the aims and what was agreed, nobody reneges on the agreements, because that's another thing that we tend to find here. Negotiations are only as good as the results, the tangible
results.
Let's
commend the Nigeria Governors Forum for intervening, where the Ministry of Health failed woefully and made statements that can only be considered totally embarrassing. So let's hope that the Nigeria Governors Forum, stepping in now, will be able to resolve the problem and bring the two parties back to the negotiating table, so that, you know, we don't find a situation whereby at a time when Nigeria faces a public health crisis, resident doctors and, you know, other doctors, other medical workers will be on strike to the disadvantage of the average Nigerian who needs health care.
Right, let's see how all of this pans out. Some things have been done already. The insurance policy of about $4 to $9 billion that we talked about here last week. Let's see how this pans out in the coming weeks. That's all on Headline News. We'll take a short break now. When we return, we'll have the trio of Rotus Odiri, Michael Wilson, and Aaron Akurajola to give us updates on Africa, global business, and COVID-19. Stay with us.
Welcome back to The Morning Show here on Arise News. Our dependable Rotus Odiri is now here to give us Africa business update. Good morning, Rotus. Over to you.
Good morning, Doctor. Good morning. Good morning, Tundu, and good morning, Rufai. So we kick things off with the oil and gas industry. Seplat, which is an indigenous oil and gas firm here in Nigeria, announced to the Nigerian Stock Exchange that they are now a fully fledged holdco. A holdco is basically a subsidiary. It's an abbreviation for a holding company. We're looking at their seven wholly owned subsidiaries there. And basically, a holding company exercises control over one or more additional firms. This is something that has been in the works for quite a while. It's not going to affect the, you know, operational efficiency of the company. And essentially, they're going to be transferring some of their assets, the OML 4, 38, and 41 from the holdco over to Seplat West Limited, which is the seventh company that you're seeing at the bottom there. So it's essentially something the company has been talking about. That's their stock price. They are listed, of course, on the London Stock Exchange and also on the Nigerian Stock Exchange. So we're seeing their stock price there, which was closed flat £60 40 pence on the London Stock Exchange as of Friday, and then also on the Nigerian Stock Exchange, although it's been a bit of a struggle on the Nigerian Stock Exchange, at 386 as of Friday. The IPO price was about, I think it was about 600 or so, 2015, when the stock debuted on the exchange. So essentially, it's, you know, fully fledged holdco company now. They're going to be pushing forward, be more efficient, more lean. There'll be less regulatory hurdles if they want to make strategic decisions. And essentially, that's just an announcement that the company made to the stock exchange. The government doesn't have to worry about any reduction in tax revenue or anything like that. Everything is still going to move smoothly. So it's just pretty much an announcement from the company about being a fully fledged holdco, which is a holding company. From oil and gas, we move to the Vice President Osibanjo and Lamido Sanusi. Here's a quote here from a chat that they had, a webinar on economic stability beyond COVID-19. Sanusi says here, Atlanta has a GDP that is higher than Nigeria, and Atlanta is not the richest city in the USA. It also says, I don't mean to be disrespectful, but the annual sales of Tesla, owned by Elon Musk, exceed the budget of Nigeria. We need to cut our coats according to our cloth. And he was quizzing Vice President Osibanjo about the high cost of governance. And Professor Osibanjo admitted it. He said, yes, cost of governance is running into almost 70% of our revenues. He then said, we need to have a debate, a national debate, about how to reduce costs. Now, Sanusi then suggested that we move from a bicameral legislature to a unicameral legislature. He said that lawmakers should be part-time, and also, you know, other affairs need to be, you know, deregulated, in government. Now, Vice President Osibanjo said that, look, the people who are supposed to be voting to go from a bicameral to a unicameral legislature and become part-time legislators in order to reduce costs are the same people who are going to be voting for that measure. So he says there might be a challenge there, but it's something that has to be done. So, you know, good on Vice President Osibanjo calling for a debate, but one will probably say that it's, you know, something that should have taken place for a while back, because former MES Sanusi, former Central Bank Governor Sanusi, has been pushing for this for quite a while. Third topic, unemployment. There was a tweet that tagged Yemi Kale, the Statistician General of the Bureau of Statistics. It says here, dear Doc, the last unemployment report was released by the National Bureau of Statistics. It was in Q3 2018. How are policymakers expected to make informed decisions, particularly in this recessionary period where layoffs have heightened? Please, can you look into this? And he responded. He responded to him and said that, look, you know, pending receipts of funds and after working around COVID-related disruptions to our work, the updated unemployment survey to Q2 2020, which is where we are, has started and we will publish once completed. He didn't give a date, though, but I flagged that tweet because I was actually tagged in that tweet, so I quickly caught it and thought to talk about it. So it's good to at least have him come out and say they started work and we should expect those figures. And then finally, from South Africa, SentB, which is a fintech company, is allowing for people to pay for data, to pay for electricity, and also to pay for a number of other things using Bitcoin SV. So Bitcoin SV stands for Bitcoin Satoshi Vision. There's a bit of a, you know, there are different factions with Bitcoin when it comes to cryptocurrencies. If you see these four different prices here, Bitcoin, Ethereum, XRP, Bitcoin, look at Bitcoin SV. That's at the far right at $172.85. Bitcoin SV is based on this, a peer-to-peer electronic cash system, which was written by this anonymous figure, Satoshi Nakamoto, back in 2008. So there are many factions. They've separated themselves, but this is actually supposed to bring more trust towards Bitcoin being a form of exchange, actually acting like money instead of a speculative asset that's been used in the past. Although the challenge still is that there are so many different factions of Bitcoin and so many different Bitcoin Cash, Bitcoin Unlimited, Bitcoin this, Bitcoin that. But what this company is doing, SentB, actually now allows people in South Africa and Johannesburg, especially where the company is based, to actually use Bitcoin now to make actual payments. So, you know, we'll see, actually on the Global Business Report about 11:30 or so, we're supposed to have a software engineer who is in the e-commerce space to talk about what this means, because he believes it's a preservation of value for Africans. So that's what's going on.
Rotus, I would like to come in here because this is really very important. I want you to talk us through what the CBN policy is on Bitcoin, because only a couple of years back, I think it was Jimmy Dimon of what's the bank called now?
JP Morgan.
JP Morgan. Yeah. Thank you for that. The gentleman of JP Morgan said, I'm going to invest heavily into Bitcoin. And he didn't buy some Bitcoin. A lot of people are talking about, you know, Bitcoin being the alternative to cash in the future. A lot of people are trading with it. A lot of people are buying stuff with it. What's the CBN policy? Because I know it was an outright ban at some point when people started pushing Bitcoin in Nigeria. Well, what's the new policy thinking about Bitcoin?
Yeah, the CBN actually held some forums. I attended one 2 years ago. I believe it was 2017 or 2018 or so. They actually held one here in Lagos. I attended it. And they were held conversations. They brought some Bitcoin exchange people there. They said they were going to be looking at it. But since then, there hasn't been any movement since that time. But the CBN did actually take notice. Yes, you're right. There was a ban. And they said it's speculative because there have been a lot of scams and hacking associated with it. Also, the price fluctuations. This thing went from under $1,000 at the beginning of 2017 to $19,000 around December of 2017. Then fell to $15,000. Now, Bitcoin is about $9,000 or so, if you see those prices we had up there. So CBN actually wanted to do something, but right now with COVID-19, everything else, they've taken a step back, so we'll have to see what happens.
The thing about Bitcoin is that in terms of the regulatory framework, it remains uncharted territory.
Yes, yes.
And that's why financial advisors say that Nigerians who are interested should be very careful. Mm. Now, as to the point about Yemi Khaled's response to a tweet, he actually participated in a webinar about a week ago in which he addressed the issue and gave indications of what may well happen. And he was quoted as having said that the unemployment figures for quarter two may be maybe above 13%, maybe above 13.4%. And that's understandable, considering the fact of the impact of COVID-19 during the second quarter, as we have seen it.
I have a comment to make about Lamido Sanusi's comments with the vice president and the fact that 70% spent on overheads is completely unsustainable. But look at how long it took to even implement the Orosanye report, almost 8 years. So when we talk about a national debate in such an open-ended fashion, when is that going to be held? And I do agree that we need a unicameral, not bicameral legislation. Yeah. We can't afford it.
Correct.
Anyway, thank you, Rotus. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
And now for more business updates, we're joining Michael Wilson in London. Good morning, Mr. Wilson.
Good morning. What we're looking at here, the overall narrative, really, the overarching narrative, is one of a possible second spike in the pandemic. As far as the United States is concerned, for example, the second wave has become a theme. The increase in states like Florida and South Carolina are big enough to be able to say this, there probably is a second spike somewhere. And also, the World Health Organization has said over the weekend that the pandemic is accelerating globally. So European markets actually finished, well, Asia is kind of taking a bit in its stride. There's not much to say about the Asian markets. They're pretty flat overnight. But the European equity markets finished slightly positive on Friday, despite last week's modest stabilization. There's still this concern, really, about a rise in infection rates in China, Japan, India, and as I mentioned, a couple of US states as well. So not many people actually around and about at the moment, you can see from those kind of pictures. And also, there's a feeling that once again, this recovery may well get derailed as companies and businesses try to work out what to do. Here's one for you as well, that in Germany, in localized coronavirus cases, raised concern about a second wave in Germany. Now, Germany, as you know, well known for having tackled this actually rather well. But the on the 7-day average, the R number, I'm sorry to get technical about this, but I'm sure by now you know what I mean. The Germany is widely lauded for this, but it has actually grown very, 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 very slightly. So basically, everybody's fairly nervous this week. And I think people will be looking at each other to try to find out what kind of signs we can actually glean from what's happening, because I think one thing's pretty clear from all this, that the health authorities themselves are trying to apply all sorts of different standards to things, and there is nothing actually done right at the moment that's saying this is the benchmark, this is the way in which this is going to go. So that's Germany. As far as UK is concerned, whisperings that there might be a cut in VAT, that's a purchase tax, plus a reduction rate for some other sectors. It will only be temporary. The bad news is, of course, as you well know, that there's no such thing as a silver lining. There may be an autumn budget here which increases tax and spending. The UK will today also tighten, and it will have effect from today if it passes, takeover laws to ensure that British businesses who are doing something to counteract the pandemic are protected from foreign takeovers. That's all part of much wider legislation called the National Security and Investment Bill that will probably that will be put before Parliament towards the end of the year. But that will give the UK government further powers to intervene if they feel as though parts of the economy being sold to foreign powers. It's a kind of nationalistic move. As far as Brexit's concerned, maybe a breakthrough by June the 29th on Brexit. They're working on plans today. There are talks this week. June the 29th is only a week away. There's an atmosphere of greater willingness to do business. That seems to be also extending to EU and China trade as well. The European Union and China will seek to cool the various tensions that have happened there in a video summit today. There won't be a formal communique, but it is taking place. As far as commodities are concerned, gold creeping up to that sort of 2000 level. Do you think it is? I don't know about that, but it's about 1765 an ounce at the moment. So it's testing those kind of levels, and oil prices nudging slightly higher. The problem with all that is, again, that they are, but at the same time, there's this feeling about, you know, it's all about this demand-led, really, as I was saying to you on Friday. That's the thing to watch for, as well as the stockpiles. And also, shale producers at these kind of prices are technically insolvent at these kind of levels. So that's helping producers of black gold to be slightly more optimistic about the price. I've got a nice quote for you, actually. I was reading over the weekend. It's a good thing to think about in the background. It says, health is the freedom to live a life that you have a reason to value and the responsibility not to harm others in doing so. I rather like that quote, actually. That's something which we all really need to bear in mind. And I want to, finally, can I introduce you to a girlfriend of mine? She's called Tina. Tina was around in the mid-70s. Tina stands for There Is No Alternative, T-I-N-A. And there are things called Tina trades at the moment. And the fact that there are Tina trades, this is why the equity markets are doing so well, because clients are getting onto asset managers saying, we want higher returns. And this is one of the reasons why the stock market is so high at the moment, despite what's happening in the real economy, because of Tina. There is no alternative, and so people are going for riskier assets. That's the global outlook for Monday morning.
Well, Michael, I would like to have your thoughts on this controversy about whether there is a second wave or not. Mike Ryan, the executive director of the WHO in charge of the pandemic, the emergencies, says this is not a second wave, because a second wave will mean that the disease has more or less gone down and then it will reappear. But what we're seeing is the effect of the easing of the lockdown in various countries, as you have seen in China, in South Korea, in Montenegro, and also, well, worst-case scenario in Brazil. But what do you think should be the strategy when countries are faced with this spike that we're seeing? Should it be another round of lockdown or micro-processes? And do you think that the authorities are underestimating the impact of the pandemic?
All right, a lot of questions there. I think that basically it's juggling this business, isn't it, Reuben? We've talked about this before. It's juggling the survival of an economy. We don't want to be, the UK, for example, does not want to be a sort of combination of an economic crash and an education crash as well. We are weirdly, in this country, a place where you can go shopping, but the schools are not going to open until the autumn, if indeed they do. Now, You cannot have a functioning economy without education, because if you don't educate your children, then, I mean, shopping is important, the economy is important, but fundamentally, I think it's about education. And I think at some stage, we're going to have to take a risk. And as I was saying on Friday, again, I feel as though people, there is no safety in the world. There never has been. We have not found something to deal even with the common cold yet. We may have to balance this. We may have to see little spikes here and there and worry about them and deal with them, provided we are hygienic, provided we wear face masks, provided we wash our hands and do everything that we actually can. As they understand it at the moment, coronavirus will just disappear because it feeds on itself. And when it can't feed on anything, just like most viruses, it'll go. Will there be an underlying coronavirus? I suspect there probably will be. Will we, like a lot of teachers, for example, and I mean, you know, again, I talk to some of my friends that are teachers, and they say, you know, before all this, we were going into classrooms facing all sorts of infections from kids and so on. Did we catch them? No, we didn't. Why did we not? Because we built up our own biological defences to them. This may be the way forward. I think it's crude to talk about herd immunity, but to answer your question, I think the fundamentals are education before the economy, and I think the economy will follow.
All right, Michael, I want to be a little bit very cheeky this morning. Was Tina really beautiful? That's one. And secondly, Michael, I want to talk about reports coming out that Rishi Sunak is looking at really those VAT numbers with the intent of probably at some point he might reduce it.
I want to piggyback on Rufai's question. It's like, it reminds me of those war posters, your country needs you, when the British public is required to come out and shop. And every effort has been made to encourage that.
Yeah, I think so. And I think that they did reduce VAT slightly. Well, it's more than slightly. It was 20% just after the financial crisis, and they reduced it temporarily to 15%. It's now 20% again. I mean, if there is a reduction, it will only be a temporary one, but also added to that cocktail of trying to get the economy going again, it might be that certain sectors find themselves with less VAT than they have at the moment. But it will only be a temporary thing. VAT is a very, very convenient and simple way for a government to tax us all, because as soon as goods are exchanged, VAT is applicable to that exchange. So basically, it's a purchase tax. It's very neat and it applies widely. The bad thing about VAT is that it tends to apply to poorer people slightly worse than richer people, because it applies to the actual fundamentals of life, like power and food and so on.
Thank you so much.
Mr. Wilson. Now, with an update on the COVID-19 pandemic, Aaron Akerejala is here with us. Good morning, Aaron.
Hey, good morning, Tundu. I must say, you look unblemished in white today.
How kind. Thank you.
All right. And good morning.
At least you got the name right today.
Good morning, Aaron.
You got the name right today. Hallelujah.
I don't make mistakes twice, I must actually say.
Oh, yeah.
Good morning, Doctor. Hope you had a lovely weekend.
Yeah, thank you.
Let's get straight into today's numbers and how things are actually playing out. We started off in Africa, looking at the African perspective, the African landscape in terms of COVID-19, if they can actually help us with the figures. Now, Africa has actually surpassed the 300,000 mark in number of confirmed cases. As a matter of fact, we have 306,567 confirmed cases of COVID-19 in Africa. We're just at 8,115. And a whopping recovery of 146,212. As a matter of fact, Egypt and South Africa make up 48.7% of that actual number of cases. All right, you can actually see the breakdown there. South Africa has the most, 97,302. But remember, South Africa have tested well over 1.3 million people till date. Nigeria is second with 20,244. Then, I beg your pardon, Nigeria is third, rather, behind Egypt. We have 55,233. Then Ghana also, we are seeing a spike in Ghana, Cameroon, Algeria. But without a doubt, South Africa and Egypt are taking the cake for it. 48.7% of the cases of coronavirus in Africa is between South Africa and Egypt. If we're to move on
To break it down to regions, we can see we've been speaking about the Western Cape province in South Africa, all right, has been the hotbed and one of those flashpoints of COVID-19, and it has 51,441 of those cases as of yesterday night, and followed by Lagos, which has 8,576, then Greater Accra, then Khartoum, then Grand Abidjan. But you can see there, without a doubt, what is happening in Western Cape province is still confounding a lot of people out there, not knowing what is really going on there, because COVID-19 is really, really ravaging that particular place. Remember, South Africa have actually opened their economy because Cyril Ramaphosa has said that they have no choice but to do this. If we are actually to move on from there, move on from Africa right now, look at the broader scope of things, how things are actually playing out. Another hotbed for COVID-19. Okay, these are the numbers for Nigeria, 20,244, like we rightly said before. Moving away from that to South America. All right, South America has seen quite a lot of upsurge in the number of cases. Brazil coming into context here with over 1 million cases in South America. And of course, 1,086,990 are the number of cases, and they've also passed the 50,000 death mark for number of for those who have died of COVID-19. All right, Jair Bolsonaro is still insistent that, as it stands right now, the economy or the whole landscape in Brazil cannot be closed because it will devastate the economy. Rather than people will die more from hunger, he says, than from COVID-19. That is still his belief. He holds on to that. He's disregarded World Health Organization's regulations and advice at the moment. We're seeing things happen. Brazil, Peru, Chile. We're seeing these places actually have a massive upsurge. As it stands right now, the entirety of Latin America has well over 2 million confirmed cases of COVID-19. And over 1 million of those is from Brazil alone. It says a lot about what is happening. But before I come to you guys, let's actually beam the searchlight and actually chime into the United States, where things are actually going on. As you can actually see right now, the United States have 2,279,879. I was almost mixing that one up there, but let's get it straight here. As it stands right now, those are the breakdown in the number of cases or positive cases that are coming back from testing. Remember, President Donald Trump claims that the reason why we're seeing an upsurge in the number of COVID-19 cases is because they are the ones that have done the most testing in the world. They claim to have done 25 million tests as of yesterday. 25 million tests have been done too on several Americans, and you can actually see the spike there. Arizona, Alabama, Washington, South Carolina, Utah, Texas. But experts say that it is not because a lot of testing is being done, but rather it's because the easing of lockdown in some of those places saw the sharp spike. All right, this was what was expected when the lockdown was being eased by the WHO. You can see that level of line there. But when things started spiraling out of control and actually going far beyond that line, as you can see in the likes of Arizona, Alabama, all down to even Louisiana, then it's only down to one thing, which is scientific. And that's something that President Donald Trump and Jair Bolsonaro have actually ignored, scientific approach to COVID-19. The world numbers stands as we are on the brink of hitting 9 million as of this morning, 8,952,428. That was as at 5:33 this morning. By now, if the numbers are to be tallied in the next 60 minutes, we are well over 9 million as we speak right now of COVID-19. All right, for the global debt, 468,346 is where we stand right now.
Mm. Well, without a doubt, what we're dealing with in Brazil is not just COVID-19. We're also dealing with another form of disease that is better described as a Bolsonaro virus. Because as we have said again and again on this program, the problem is Jair Bolsonaro himself. Mm. Now, two health ministers in that country have resigned.
Yes.
And the man who is in charge of the COVID-19 pandemic in that country at the moment is a general who knows nothing absolutely nothing about public health. And the sadder point about Brazil is that we haven't even seen the peak yet. So the situation is likely to get worse. Now, it's not just in Brazil, in that region, that you have issues. Also in Mexico, in the last 48 hours, the numbers have been going up in Mexico and also in Venezuela. Now, as for the United States, the situation is similar. I think part of the problem is President Trump, who held a rally over the weekend in Tulsa, Oklahoma. And if you looked at the people at that rally, they were protesting more or less against COVID-19 because most of them were not using face masks, even if the fact is that, look, the attendance was very poor. And you heard at that rally President Trump saying testing is a double-edged sword, although a State House official, a White House official said he was joking. Now, that was quite an expensive joke, which, as you pointed out, runs against what science and the experts tell us. And then as for Africa, well, I'm surprised you left out Zimbabwe, where the minister of health has been charged to court for a contract scam running into about $20 million. And that's the second minister in that country that will be charged to court over corruption, coronavirus corruption. And interestingly, here in Nigeria, Serap, an NGO, has also gone to court that since March 20, he's been trying to get information about the management of funds for coronavirus in Nigeria. I hope that we will not get to a point where we will have similar stories coming out of Nigeria.
So add to what you said is that the fact that Donald Trump is leaving that disappointing outing in Oklahoma, and the next stop of the Trump campaign rallies is Arizona. And look at that chart that you just showed. And you can imagine a rally, and now they're going to do everything to fill the space to capacity without people wearing masks. With these kind of statistics, it's actually extremely alarming.
I mean, I know for a fact, no matter how Kellyanne Conway feels about this, Trump is not going to fill those rallies.